First of all, let me thank Dr. Marinal Rastoli, the wonderful organizer and also very good scholar. And we met many times all around the world, not recently in Turin, as the Italian Association of Sanskrit Studies, of which I am the president, and Marinal was there. So the topic of my lecture is Abhinavagupta as an aristocrat. What is the meaning? In a sense, the meaning is concealed in the verse by Torella. I put in excerpt in my article. For the moment, I will quote him in the original French. Then, at the very end of this presentation, you will realize why I put this verse in excerpt. I hope that at least some of you know French. Mais le calme et au fond, courbé sur sa rivière, regardait le sillage et ne daignait rien voir. Et I will be mostly reading, because this paper is not yet published, but it is still in a written form. It is about to be published in a collection of studies in honor of Christina Scherer-Schaub. Christina, she is an eminent ethologist and also my friend. And I consider Christina as an aristocrat. She is an aristocrat. That's why I choose this topic for their certification volume. While in the past I took almost for granted that the grounds of Abhinavagupta's aesthetic thought were to be found in his philosophical religious speculation, in the course of time my feeling has been gradually changed. And now I am more and more inclined to give prominence to a basic aesthetic value as the more or less hidden background of his activity as a whole. I remember years ago I gave as a subject of thesis MA thesis to Daniele Cuneo. Daniele Cuneo is well known also Marinal. Daniele Cuneo is one of my best students now. He teaches at Sorbonne Bello in Paris. The title of his MA thesis was The Philosophical Basis, mainly the Pratia Linea Basis of Abhinavagupta's aesthetics. Now I could make the inversion, the aesthetic basis of Raffaele. This aesthetic flavour goes hand by hand with an aristocratic attitude. The latter being allegedly the very source where the former stems from. The major characteristic of the aristocratic attitude is the downgrading of all painful effort, seen as plebeian feature. The aristocrat intends to show that what inferior people can achieve (clears throat) What the inferior people can achieve only at the cost of long and painful exercises is accessible to him promptly and then easily. This can be detected in Abhinavagupta's attitude to yoga, or to be more precise, to Patanjala yoga. In his Lojana on Vanyaloka 1.6, Abhinavagupta quotes and comments on the shloka by Bhattanayaka, as Professor Rajendran said, Bhattanayaka is a powerful source of inspiration of Abhinavagupta. So probably, as far as philosophical approach, there would have been no Abhinavagupta without Uppaladeva. Probably there would be no Abhinavagupta as a philosopher of aesthetics without Bhattanayaka, even though he likes criticizing strongly and in a sense concealing his indebtedness. In the summary of the topics of the Tantra Loka, at the end of Agnika 1, he lists Yoga Anga Anupayodhittvam and Kalpita Archa Adi Anagara. The uselessness of the Angas of Yoga, though being a leitmotif of the entire work, receives a specific treatment in Agnika 4, apparently following the authority of the Vilabhari Tantra. After liquidating with few disdainful words yama, niyama, asana, and pranayama, the external angas, he sets out to an apparently more difficult task, showing the uselessness also of the internal angas, that is pratyahara, dharana, dhyana, and samadhi. Here, I will not delve into the very interesting criticism of the single angas, a topic which I have treated in a separate paper. This paper has been published last month in the Journal of American Oriental Society. And the title is Abhinavagupta's Attitude Towards Yoga. Now I can also say very few words about the main points. Withdrawing the senses from their objects results in reinforcing the bondage instead of losing it, in that it suggests the idea that consciousness resides in some places and not in others. Then, referring to what Abhinava says as the world, we may add that Pratyahara has the negative effect of reducing the capacity of the sensorial faculties, which we should always keep in mind, they are devata, no? In our indriyas, they are karavirvari, they are just forms of the shakti, of the supreme shakti. They are, as Pratyahara has the negative effect of reducing the capacity of the sensorial faculties, sambhiti devis, to assimilate the external reality to consciousness. So the only way we have to assimilate external reality is to introduce it into our consciousness. and to make it a part of ourselves. So in this way, the Bhagavata sees to be such. But without this, let's say, digestion effect, what is outside will remain outside forever. Meditating on a single object and only on the series of homogeneous cognitions related to it would leave otherness outside. This is the main criticism to Dhyana. Dhyana of homogeneity and so in this way we are trying to keep away otherness. But is it useful to keep others away? Or our internal structure, or the very source of our energy, comes from confronting ourselves with the other. Now, in this case, Diana tried to cancel the other. No? Is this useful? In one of the questions of the crucial questions of the so-called Kashmishaivism, of non-dual Kashmishaivism, is one is about otherness, one is about control. And if we can read Abhinavagupta's work as a kind of long reply to this very simple question, is control possible? Assuming that it is possible, is it useful? So let's go. Merging into the object of cognition, samadhi, derives consciousness of the dynamic tension between cognizer and cognized. But even more subtly, two basic shortcomings are at work in the angas of Patanjala Yoga and are more or less explicitly demarcated. The very term anga is to be understood as something which has no value in itself, but only as a means. The very term anga is to be understood, as you know very well, anga has several meanings in Sanskrit. The meaning, which is been assumed by not only by Abhinavagupta, but before him, not by the Virabali Tantra. The Virabali Tantra is a wonderful text, which unfortunately has not come down to us. And we can quote it only from scattered quotation, particularly by Abhinavagupta. It was a text belonging to probably to the Nirachara stream, full of extremely interesting observations, which are quite unusual in Tantra. Particularly the one when he defines Pratyahara is really wonderful. Anibadasya Kitadavra is really wonderful. But let's go on. It's to be understood as something which has no value in itself, but only as a means to reach the immediately higher anger. None of them is by itself a means to consciousness. Only Tarka being a real upaya to it. This evokes the image of a ladder going painfully higher and higher and presupposes that consciousness can be realized bit by bit. To the earlier point, a straightforward answer can be found in the Paratrimshika Vivaranam, which says, our view is so called in that there is in it no ascending. Isn't that curious, no? Because we are ready to think that the spiritual path is a kind of going up and up, like in the salita Monte Carmelo of Giovanni della Croce. So, is the kind of ascension. No? Instead, Abhinavagupta here is playing with the word anuttara. In the Paratunisha Vivaranam, he gives something like 16 different meanings of anuttara, all of them firmly grounded on Sanskrit grammar, because you can't say anything about against this translation. And it's not that the next interpretation cancels the previous one. No, they are side by side enriching this similar word, anuttara, with an octopus meaning. On one occasion, years ago, because I also give seminars for the yoga teachers and also for people interested in Indian philosophy outside the university, because I think that we should be able to communicate these wonderful things we can find in these unique authors. So I'm full of with admiration with when I read Uttaradeva or Abhinavagupta or these people. Really, sometimes I stop and I say, kind of minds, brilliant minds at these people. So, so I try also to communicate these things to a wider audience, apart from me, myself, a specialist, and if I want to, I will speak in which only 10 people can understand me. But why? Why to do so? So in this case, our view is so cold in that there is in it no ascending. An uttara. Uttara being taken as a no means ascending. That is, there is no liberation conceived as progressive elevation from the body to prana and so on, as conceived by dualistic doctrines. Then he concludes, for ascending is useless. And again, in the same text, in the Paratrinsika Vivaranam, some pages later, Paratrinsika Vivaranam is one of the most difficult and fascinating texts of Abhinavagupta. Extremely difficult because it's a kind of dialogue of Abhinavagupta with himself, reflecting on this tantra of 30 verses and developing a lot of very unique and very personal considerations dealing with, let's say, philosophical language, with ritual, with aesthetics and psychology and so on and so on. It's a really unique text. this text has been translated by my guru, my personal, my guru, Raffaele, at the book I wanted to do the very beginning, which I usually do in India, at the outset of my lectures, is to pay tribute to my parampara, not to my, so my guru and also my predecessor in the chair of Sanskrit at Sapienza has been Raniero Gnoli. I think that most of you will know Raniero Gnoli. known him, because he's widely known in India too. And the Premier Agnoli in 1 week with Fest is 19 birthday, and I have organized on 24 of March a day in which with me and other colleagues, mainly disciples of Premier Agnoli, will discuss about the legacy of Premier Agnoli as a scholar. And my Paramaguru was Giuseppe Pucci. This is the parampara of the Sapienza. I'm afraid that now the illustrious parampara of Sapienza will come to an end, and the, after the Sapienza, Rome Sapienza parampara, will come the Naples parampara with my student. Former student Francesco Sferra, excellent student, and I think that from Rome this parampara will move to Naples. So this passage from the Paradigmatica Vivarium is also very beautiful. Unfortunately, I cannot give you the Sanskrit text because it is, there is no handout for this. I was about to prepare it, but at the very last time I couldn't find the time. But the objection. But the one who wants to assent and desires to know the sense of the clicker, how can he assent? Reply. But whose is such desire? He shouldn't ascend at all. If he has this intention, let him resort to the ritual procedure of the Siddhanta Tantras and so on, and the contraction characterizing the visualization, dhyana, and so on, described there. This person is not qualified for the anuttara state, where there is no contraction. The yoga we are referring to is an ever-present yoga, sadodita yoga, devoid of contraction. End of quotation. As to the second point, that is the gradual realization of consciousness, Abhinavagupta is equally categorical. What is already rooted in consciousness can be gradually transmitted to prana, body, mind, by the repeated practice of this yogangas. Whereas this procedure is not applicable to consciousness. In other words, if abhyasa may be applied to the domain of the yogangas, for sure it is of no use at all for consciousness. No slow and painful ascent, step by step, but only an elegant, powerful and effortless jump is effective. One of the recurring qualifications for Abhinavagupta's attitude to spiritual path is precisely absence of effort, yatna, prayatna, absence of exertion or fatigue, ayasa, prayasa, easiness, sukha, Sugat. This is especially connected by him with the Kula. He says, in the Kula view, all these ritual prescriptions are abandoned, since the Kula teaches an easy means. With in our mind, we could think about a verse which touches on the same topic, and this verse is in fact quoted by Jayartha in his commentary on this passage, without saying, without giving any reference, but I can give you the reference. The verse says, the ancient masters have shown how to block the mind through detachment and repeated practice. You see, Niroga, Vairagya, and Abhyasa, the very basis of Patanjara Yoga. So this is the ancient masters. Instead, we will teach how to obtain its blocking with no effort. Adigatunena. And this verse comes from Svoboda Udaya Manjari by Tamaradatta. I have devoted some study still, and I'm still working on Ramanadatta. Probably there are two Ramanadattas, most probably. One Ramanadatta is this Ramanadatta, is a Shaiva author, more or less 10th century, half 10th century, who also wrote the first commentary of the Vinayavaya. At least his Vaya Sampativartika is a commentary on two verses of Vinayavaya. I remember that I discussed with Professor Rastogi in his The Krama Fantasism of Kashmir, because he made an emendation to Vaya Sampativartika, and he said Ad Vaya Sampativartika, because he said it was Ad Vaya Sampativartika. But I told him that this Dvaya has nothing to do with the philosophical position, but just the fact that it is commenting on two verses. And this is the first witness of the The other Vamanadatta, this is a very important author, this is a Vaishnava, being assumed as teacher by Abhinavagupta. Abhinavagupta doesn't refrain from considering his own teachers, also people, gurus belonging to different traditions. In this case, he is well aware that Vamanadatta is a Pancharatrika, is a Vaishnava, but he quotes him with a lot of respect. And Vamanadatta, if you read the so-called, let's say, Sambit Prakasha has been very badly edited by Martin Tchaikovsky. You should forget about it, that edition. In fact, it is also, I have realized, if you know something more about this extremely interesting author, which is a Vaishnava, but deeply influenced by the Paramadvaita of Kashmir, it looks like, if you read it, apart from the color from which he says, I'm a Kayana, and so on, it looks like a second of Paradeva. Also very elegant, and also very deep in his more or less Kavya style, to be a kind of philosophical Kavya. It's a kind of dialogue with Hari. Sandeep Prakash is, in fact, the title of your first treatise, Sandeep Prakash. Then we have only three manuscripts, three fragmentary manuscripts of this work. There are seven prakaranas. The second prakarana is Atma Sapta, it's also very important and often quoted. And you can see how ideas propagate in Kashmir of the time, and how even Vaishnavas were exposed to the fascination of this unique philosophers like Uttaradeva and Abhinavagupta. So let's go back to our text. These qualifications can be found, qualification I mean absence of effort, easiness, and so on, in the definition of the special yoga taught by the Shaiva tradition. See, for example, the oft-quoted definition of yoga given by the core text of the Tantra Yoga, the Manini Vijaya. Because when the Shaiva authors want to give a definition of yoga, invariably they go to this verse of the Manini Vijaya Tara, which curiously is not can be found in the edition of the Manini Vijaya Tara. You know that all the Tantra Loka can be considered as an enormous commentary on Manini Vijaya, is a paddati on Manini Vijaya Loka. And also in the conclusion of the core text of the Pratyabhinaya, the Ishvara Pratyabhinaya, yet, in this definition, I discussed and I examined in depth this definition in my article. You can see in this Jaws article. Also, the definition is very interesting because he says a very strange things. Yoga is unification of something with aniena vastuna, with some other things. It's quite fun. And according to Abhinavagupta, what the Manini Vijaya Ottara had in mind is a very refined means that this aniena vastuna means that yoga is able to connect anything with consciousness. So this is a very original, I can't say that it was the original meaning of the Manini Vijaya Ottara quotation, but it is evidently. Then, yet, one of the early texts of non-dualistic Shaivism, the Shiva Sutra, apparently praises Prayatna, considered as the only means for realizing mantra, Prayatna Sadhana. However, according to the oxymoron that Ksemaraja uses in his Vimarshini, this is a non-constructed, spontaneous effort, a kind of subtle inner tension in which Shakti manifests pizza. Also, in on other occasions, we can find a distinction between external and internal effort. Prayashna, understood in this way, is assimilated to a constellation of terms with similar meaning, such as Udyoga, Udyama, Samrambha. On Samrambha, we should say something more, because I think Samrambha is a very neglected term in Shaiva, let's say, the terminology. In Samrambha, because now I'm writing a longish essay on Chamatkara. No? On Chamatkara, this essay will be published in a volume in Japan, in Kyoto, and is still in progress. And one of the points I have examined is the correlation between Samrambha. What is the meaning of Samrambha? Samrambha is impetus, no? A kind of also violence, something very dynamic. And the term Samrambha is a very crucial term because it is the one which can make the difference between Vimarsha and Chamatkara. I can't delve into this point, which is extremely interesting. I can also say that in my study of Chamatkara, I have definitively realized that Chamatkara has nothing to do with the wonder, amazement, and something like this. It's totally different. The philosophical meaning in Abhinavagupta or Paradeva, we should always keep in mind that most of these ideas are already been produced by Paradeva. Now, as I have shown in many of my papers, the real gravity center of Pratibhinaya philosophy and of non-dual Shaivism is not the world, is Upparadeva. And in one of my papers I defined, with scandalizing my Indian colleagues, that from now onwards we should consider Upparadeva just as the brilliant commentator of, Abhinavagupta, the brilliant commentator of Upparadeva. No. So, Samrambha, there is a famous passage of the Bhigavati Vimarshini in which Abhinavagupta asks himself a question. No? Why, instead of saying there is no ajadhyam, there is no sensitivity, in this reality, because there is no Chamatkara. No? This is very important. Probably this is the point in which Chamatkara comes to the foreground in Indian philosophical discussion. Of course, the term Chamatkara existed before with a different meaning, and it became so in two centuries, Chamatkara was became one of the pivotal terms of aesthetics and philosophy. After that, in my opinion, Chamatkara turned back to the old meaning, wonder, and so on. But in this text, in our text, in the Duanya Loka Lochana, in the meaning is not there. Again, in the fourth chapter of the Dvanya Loka, there is the word Chamatkriya. Chamatkriya in this case means the same word. But this is another Samaramba. Samaramba impetus, violence. Abhinavagupta said, why to Paradeva, instead of saying that there is no sentience because there is no vimarsha, he said, because there is no chamatkara. Why? No. What is the difference between vimarsha and chamatkara? At this point, Abhinavagupta gives a very interesting etymological explanation of chamatkara. We can understand quite clearly that prior to him, Uttaradeva had given this interpretation, and he said practically that chamatkara is a cognitive act, is a form of vimrish, no? A way of having a reflecting awareness of something. But what differentiates chamatkara from vimarsha is the presence of one component. This component is samaramba. This means that, of course, this text has been translated many times, this passage, and always wrongly. Why my predecessors were mistaken? Because they took the text, the edited text of the Kashmir series for granted. When I read that passage, when I was a student, I immediately changed, I made a kind of inner emendation, Samrambe, I amend Samrambena, no? And I delete the comma, which has been wrongly by the editor, so, before Samrambe. No? Then, recently, we were speaking about Chetan Pandey. Chetan sent us two new manuscripts of the Biblioteca Vimarsini. And in these two manuscripts, I could find my emendation. This is Samrambena. Samrambena to be taken as a lakshana tritiya, so an instrumental with a sense of description. So this is a vimarsha characterized by special impetus. So what is the difference between the generic vimarsha and chamatkara, same meaning also in aesthetic thought, is a much deeper awareness of the object. So the object is violently appropriated by the subject. And this is digested by the subject. Also the term Vishranti, quoted by Professor Rajendra, was not invented by Abhinavagupta, but by Uttaradeva again. So this Vishranti, Aham Vishranti, can be realized only after a violent digestion of the object. So that's why this, the presence of these violent terms in Udhyama, Udyoga, and so on, violent between the brackets, of course, is a characteristic of this wonderful text. On the other hand, the idea of easiness as absence of prayasa, ayasa, of the yogic or yogic practice is indeed present in the Shiva Sutra, in asanastha suham hrade nimajjati. The possible ambiguity of sukha is aptly underlined by the conflicting interpretations of a verse of Matanga Parinibbana Agama, given by Abhinavagupta and Saitantik Ramakanta, respectively. You know, Ramakanta, the Saitantik Ramakanta, but Ramakanta, he commented on many important agamas, among them the Sadatrisha di Kalottara, the Kirana, the Parakya, and also the Matanga Brahmeva. But we can find some hidden quotations of the Vritti on the Matanga Brahmeva in the Napraloka, which means that Ramakanta, Bhatta Ramakanta was contemporary to one probably elder contemporary of Abhinavagupta. And for Abhinavagupta, the verse says that the ritual is an easy alternative for those who are unable to follow the path of knowledge owing to their spiritual impotence. An interpretation which cannot but sound unacceptable to Ramakanta, staunch upholder of the primacy of ritual as a means for liberation. The same may be said about the traditional yoga practices. As again Pratyushika Vivarana says, in this way the nature of Anuttara has been fully ascertained, in which there is no room for meditation, dhyana, visualization, and so on, and which is accessible only through subtle spiritual contemplation. Prasankhyana. Prasankhyana is an important term, I have devoted some study to this term, which can be found in the Shankara and so on. Particularly in the meaning which Prasankhyana has in this context. Because Prasankhyana is put even at the higher level with respect to Tarka. No? But I discussed these things in the article of the Jaws article. We only through subtle spiritual contemplation, Prasankhyana, up to the point that it attains a firm grasp consisting of penetrating the heart. That is firm, wondrous savoring. Drida Chamatkara. This is a translation I made of Chamatkara, my wrong translation, but I wanted to put it because I wrote this paper before my last studies, but I wanted to keep my wrong translation, so adding this wondrous suffering. So, Chamatkara translated as wonder, as amazement, and so on, is a commonplace. No? I could say I'm mistaken, but in very good company, because the same mistake has been made by René Magnoli, Sheldon Pollock, Reed, Balsabudonis, and Deveratier, by everybody. But it is a mistake. But if one lays down the sword represented by the nobleness of means, then with regard to those who strive for the various powers, yoga is to be taught.
with regard to those who strive for the various powers, and the sword represented by the nobleness of means, in Sanskrit you have upaya, dhaureya, dara, dara. But end of profession. But even in the most widely accepted sense, easiness is really easy. Pure transformative knowledge is an easy barrier, but only for those who are qualified for it. In this way, they can get rid of the heavy burden, Ayasa, of repeated practice and so on. Interestingly, for those who are not qualified for knowledge, it is the way of knowledge to be hard and painful. This is said by Abhinavagupta and more clearly by Jayavata in his commentary. We don't need, quindi, our last question is whether easiness is really easy. We don't need to speculate about Abhinava's answer, since the latter is given in clear words at the end of an Apnika 4th. After dealing at length with the uselessness of yoga and ritual as a direct means to consciousness, and with the necessity of an effortless upaya, he concludes. Abhinavagupta speaking, Tantraloka 4278. But now, enough with such too long digressions on matters already fully explained. Only some very special sage, Abhinavagupta, would be qualified for such a sacrificial procedure. So, of course, we can say that this is not to be taken literally, as here Abhinavagupta is just playing with his name, as he will do elsewhere, also at the end of 37 Apnika. Abhinavagupta, taken in the totally different sense, not as a proper name, but protected by all parts by the Shakti or so. But sometimes play may be very serious. Two verses earlier, he said, by the smell of the Ketaki flower, only the tasteful bee is attracted, not the flies. Analogously, only some very special man, driven by the Supreme Lord, feels attraction to the supremely non-dual worship of Vairava. Here, almost casually, one more element has been added to the portrait of the ideal recipient of this teaching. He must be Rasika. Quindi, only the tasteful bee, Bringa Eva Rasika, he must be Rasika, that is aesthetically sensitive, or to use a cognate term, which holds a central position in the philosophical and aesthetic thought of Abhinavagupta, Sattvivaya, endowed with earth. Of course, there is one more meaning of Sattvivaya. This aesthetic susceptibility, as Rastogi Kunzeit is the source of chamatkar, again wrongly translated by me as wondrous suffering, another key term of Abhinavagupta's philosophy and prior to him of Upparavedas, being in its turn a major component of any dimension, reflective awareness, by which the knowing subject appropriates the object. This aesthetic attitude is not limited to the sphere of art, but is expected to embrace life itself in its entirety. Here, in the footnote, I quote a message from Daud Ali book, "The assumption in courtly circles was that rasa was experienced by men and women of rank, not merely in art, but in their worldly dealings, that the capacity to experience rasa was a way of experiencing the affective world around them. In short, the rasika was at once a moral and aesthetic world. Rasa was a sort of mental disposition which aestheticized every aspect of an individual's experience." We can find a very similar idea in the roughly contemporary Heian Japan, in which the aristocracy embraces exactly the same value as depicted by Dandali in his book. Then, the portrait of this very special religious man, eunuch, he says, Kaschut, the portrait of this very special religious man resembles more and more to that of the Indian ideal gentleman. In both, we find an innate gracefulness, elegance, aesthetic resonance, disdain for plebeian efforts, easiness. What we know about the aristocrats in Indian court, marked by the idea of dakshinya, courtly refinement, strongly reminds us of the typically aristocratic virtues depicted in one of the masterworks of Italian Renaissance, Il Libro del Cortigiano, the Book of the Courtier, by the Count of Badesar Castiglione. I like this work very much. This work was published in Venice in 1528 and soon became the standard portrait of the ideal aristocrat, being quickly translated into all the major European realms. Such easiness, as Castiglione says, may be the result of dissimulated efforts. One thing to be added is this gentle attitude, this dakshinya, this gracefulness should be united with another quality. This quality is dairya, energy, aputsaka, valor, shakya. Among the courtly elite, even as men were encouraged to cultivate gentility and compassion, they were expected to constantly display their skills in warfare, exhibit martial emotions like bravery, impetuosity, again, some random, and revenge on the battlefield, and to brutally chastise any exhibition of pride on the part of equals or inferiors. The same remark we can find at several places in the Libro del Cortigiano. This book was dedicated to the Duke Urbino, and this Duke of Urbino was a great patron of art, very refined, refined gentleman, but he was also the person who, along 20 main people, attacked and kept and took the castle of Saint-Léon, which was deemed to be impossible to. So the Duke, the very refined, the gentleman, and so on, took 20 people and they attacked and they realized this impossible task. So diarrhea, let's say, this kind of inner tension, samranga, to be taken side by side with grace, gracefulness. And Castiglione says, that's a pity that you can follow 16th century Italian, which is really beautiful. It is in the footnote. I can give you a translation. And English language. And to use possibly a new word, to practice in everything a certain nonchalance that shall conceal the sign and show that what is done and said is done without effort and almost without thought. From this, I believe, grace is in large measure derived, because everyone knows the difficulty of those things that are rare and well done, and therefore facility in them excites the highest admiration. While on the other hand, to strive and as the saying is, to drag by the air, is extremely ungraceful. It makes us esteem everything slightly, however great it is. Accordingly, we may affirm that to be true art, which doesn't not appear to be art. Nor to anything must we give credit to conceal art, for if it is discovered, it quite destroys our credit and brings us into small esteem and opposition. A very significant example of aristocratic nonchalance applied to the spiritual path can be found in Abhinavagupta's Malini Vijaya Vartika. Malini Vijaya Vartika is another work by Abhinavagupta, I should say, as difficult as the Malini Vijaya, as the Paradenshi Gavibharama. Never been translated, but most of this passage I've been quoted, never been translated before, including this one. A part of the first chapter of the Malini Vijaya Vartika has been translated by Jürgen and Eber. I was the examiner of this PhD thesis in Marburg. It is good enough that you should be careful in relying on it too much. What Abhinavagupta thought about Abhyasa, by now we already know. Now it is the turn of the other pillar of Patanjali Yoga, Vairagya. And also on another crucial theme in yoga, control. Any kind of control, yama, niyama, and so on. Abhinavagupta says,
in an individual article. In actual fact, no member of yoga can really serve as a means of achieving the condition of a Buddha. For its own form is indeed formless, as it is exempt of any limitation. The means to it is in fact a non-means, since it comprises neither ritual practices nor the blocking of mental functions. It is a boat designed for a light breeze without exhalation of inhalation, that is, without pranayama, which thereby carries itself beyond the ocean of duality, albeit in the meantime the mind is immersed in the fluid of the objective world. Let's bear in mind that the chaff of grain cannot be eliminated unless it is moistened. Likewise, consider what is involved when one decides to put the natural course of the mind under control. That is, when one wishes to put a bit on a wild bit of bird. On a wild horse. Owing to the violence of the procedures, the mind, like the horse, will start running here and there, taking many wrong directions. Why does this occur? We all know that the mind can even delight in pain. This is an important point which connects us to the aesthetic experience, and also mentioned by Professor Rajendra. The question I'm trying to answer in my current paper is possible to have the aesthetic experience of negative or painful emotions. Of course, Abhinavagupta deals with this crucial question, and he says it's possible. But before Paradeva, also before Abhinavagupta, also Paradeva dealt with this question, and before Paradeva, Somananda. Somananda is quoted many times in this context. I analyzed the context of the Shivadrishti in which Somananda makes this very strong statement, in which you can find Shiva also in endless pain. And this is taken as the very basis of a kind of aesthetic evaluation of painful experiences. Upadeva is the pivot. Upadeva takes much from Somananda, but without the contribution of Upadeva, there would have been no Pratyabhinavagupta. So we will see something about this. And Abhinavagupta is connecting the legacy of Upadeva and through Upadeva of Somananda. Of course, it will be in mind, but as far as originality is concerned, the most crucial person here is Upadeva. There is no doubt about this. So, and going into the future. Mm-hmm.
Why does this occur? We all know that the mind can even delight in pain and conversely retreat disgusted from pleasure and knowledge. This is what the master demonstrates in various forms in his treatise. The impulses of the senses can be made to cease thanks to a highly special kind of detachment, a detachment practiced in elegant stress. If, on the contrary, one attempts to subjugate them, they end up becoming unbearable. This detachment in practice in elegant stress, as I rather freely translate another virakti, this another virakti is probably the apex in the philosophical terminology, in the religious terminology, probably something in Pascal Acanta, but Pascal Acanta of course derives it from we can say something, because it is a very important term. Because virakti, in a sense, is a kind of aggressive attitude. No? Another virakti is a graceful aggressive attitude. No? It's a kind of symbol, again. But we know that these authors do like a symbol. Another more literal translation may be detachment from something by simply ignoring it. Anadara virakti. This is definitely its meaning in the context of the only other occurrence of this phrase I am aware of. In his Vyakya of Libra Patinyanti Vashini, Bhagavanta comments on an Arda Loka quoted by Abhinavagupta, Shankarina Shankieta, etc. Then, the two translations, in this case, it's clear that I have not given a translation, but the Sanskrit test is very easy. Another Adukdam, this is Anadara viraktya eva na pashyanti indriya sambhita. So, anadara means not noticing, not seeing something. So, the two translations are, to my mind, essentially equivalent. Could we ever think of a more aristocratic attitude as that of one who frees himself of hindrances simply by stating that he does not see them? It's now clear why I put other verses in example than a given translation. So, this anadara virakti may be paired with the anadara nyasa of Natya Shastra 22.16, where a beautiful and complex arrangement of different elements is achieved by the aesthetically sensitive person, giving the impression of a scenic quality. The ideal non-dualistic tantric adept comes to be a delicate balance of alertness, determination, spontaneity, and nonchalance. But where does the this aristocratic attitude of Abhinavagupta come from? Simply from the fact that he is an aristocrat. As the title accompanying his name reveals, Rajanaka, more or less hanging to the English sir. Rajanaka is attributed to persons who had in their family a royal minister. But Abhinavagupta is neither the only one, nor the first in this extraordinary chain of linguistic tribal master to have this title. The first was Upadeva, again. And we may even surmise that one of the reasons for the radical paradigm shift which took place between Upadeva and his master Somananda, I devoted the full paper to this point, how it was possible that the disciple Upadeva changed almost totally the view of his master Somananda from a very crucial point that they published in some years ago, and you can see on Academia among the papers. So it's not the first, the first was Upadeva. And we can even surmise that one of the reasons for the radical paradigm shift which took place between Upadeva and his master Somananda is to be found in their coming from different social milieus. Bhatta Somananda and Rajanaka Upadeva. This might help us explain the more relaxed and broader attitude towards opponents and allies of the latter, and the tendency to create higher synthesis vis-à-vis the philosophical and spiritual aggressiveness of Somananda. However, Upadeva and Abhinavagupta are not isolated cases. Rajanaka's were also Upa's disciple, Ramakanta. The other Ramakanta, the Sardantic, was Bhatta Ramakanta. Abhinava's disciple, Ksemaraj. Abhinava's commentator, Jagartha. And so on. Even the last great master of the Krika, last Swami Lakshmanu, was the Ramakanta. In sum, this revolutionary worldview emerged from a small circle of aristocrats. And sometimes I wonder whether ordinary devotees have ever been aware of or been able to understand these highly refined doctrines and what social impact they may have had. It is to be noted, for example, that no mention at all of Upadeva and Abhinavagupta can be found in the Raja Taranini. Thank you.